Today, three entirely disparate items. First, and inevitable, I don't know what's going on with the Ebola crisis. It seems to me so dispiriting, and it makes me so angry and frustrated. The World Health Organization seems entirely marginalized. You know, when this is all over, the Director General of the World Health Organization should be graduated to the role of a gilded clerk in some obscure corner of the bureaucracy. And the Americans, who are going to put 3,000 boots on the ground to build the clinics and the hospitals, it's moving so slowly. A lot of self-inflicted obstacles. As the New York Times has chronicled, you wonder what's happening to the most powerful nation on the planet. And then, of course, there's this fellow who has Ebola and is in hospital in Texas, and all hell broke loose. You'd think the whole country was at risk, and now an NBC cameraman will return, and the same hysteria will abound. And look at the Center for Disease Control, talk about hysteria, predicting 1,400,000 infections, possibly by January 20th, 2015. What kind of irresponsible mathematical modeling is that? It's based on the premise that nothing will happen between now and then. Well, yes, things are moving slowly. We don't have the money. We don't have the health workers. The virus is spreading. But 1,400,000? There are glimmers of hope on the ground. Look at the way Nigeria has contained the pandemic. So really, what is needed here is someone at the center, preferably the Office of the Secretary General of the UN, who holds press conferences twice a day and methodically, calmly, demonstrating control and knowledge, says what is happening in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea. But we don't have it. Multilateralism is failing us, and it's failing the people of West Africa. Let me move to point two, which is entirely unrelated. It goes back to last week at the opening of the UN General Assembly when there was a side event. And the side event consisted largely of Roche Pharmaceuticals and the Clinton Health Access Initiative and UNAIDS and PEPFAR, the Presidential Initiative on AIDS in the United States, and the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. And they all got together to say that they were going to make available through Roche viral load testing equipment to very poor countries where the number of people on antiretroviral treatment is very high. Now, up until now, we haven't had viral load machines because of the cost, but I suspect that the Clinton Health Access Initiative drove the cost down, as they so often do, and now the machines will be available. And I don't know the science of it, to be honest, but I am told and I believe that viral load monitoring is the best way to assess the progression of the disease in the body and to assess the progression as a collectivity. So, applause for all of those organizations. But who has been working so hard behind the scenes? Who's been publishing the papers, accumulating the documents and the knowledge? Who's been doing the analysis? Who's been presenting the papers at conferences? Doctors Without Borders. So there they are dealing with Ebola on the ground in West Africa, and here they are dealing with HIV/AIDS on the rest of the continent. I feel like a PR flack for Doctors Without Borders, but I'm telling you, maybe they should run the world. And if they do run the world, then the first area they should pay attention to is what's happening to the Treatment Action Campaign in South Africa. This is a magnificent organization, the best NGO dealing with HIV and AIDS across the entire African continent. It's been brilliantly led. It has grassroots support. It's rooted in communities right across South Africa. It's taken the government of South Africa on and forced the government to capitulate using a tremendous combination of judicial intervention and activism. There are 6 million infections in South Africa. They need the Treatment Action Campaign. They're in a perilous financial state because governments are cutting back. If there's some philanthropist out there, somebody who has good connections with foundations, somebody who's magnanimous with his or her wealth, the Treatment Action Campaign needs and deserves your help. They cannot be eroded in the face of the pandemic. That was last week. I'm Stephen Lewis.